My name is Kalyana Muthumuni. I'm the co-founder and director operations of Urban.lk. It's a premium online store in Sri Lanka. Today what I'm going to touch on is getting ready for investment and making sense to those who matter. So those who matter are the stakeholders, which is ideally the investors who are actually looking at your business from an objective view. So let's start with the first part of this, getting ready for investment. So there are various reasons why you would need investments, and typically a startup has to have investments. And there are different kinds of investments, and there are different stages of your startup that you should be getting for these investments as well. So you have to think about this when you are actually coming up with the startup idea as well, so that you have a proper plan on where you want the startup to go, and the timeline of how it should be. So when we consider funding, let's talk about why you need funding and when you need funding, and who you should choose to get funding from, because there are various different opportunities out there, and you have to select what is best for you. Otherwise, just because you get funding doesn't really mean that your business is going to necessarily be a success. So depending on the type of funding you get also, that can actually be a very highly valuable step in your startup's progress. Have you heard of the word MVP, the minimum viable product? So once you have the minimal viable product, you can put it out to the customers, get feedback from them. And in this step itself, you might need some funding. Usually this first step, what people do is, it's called bootstrapping. We'll get into that a little later. So in this step also, there are a few things that you need to do. You have to market your product, you have to reach customers. And in some cases, it's not cost effective to actually do this from your own money and do it in a small scale. Sometimes you need a little bit more money to actually reach a number of people so that you have some data that actually makes sense to you. Let's say you are releasing a product and you need to see how the market reacts to this. So you can't really be sending this out to 5 or 10 people. You need to reach a considerable number of people. So from the start itself, you will actually need funding. So that is one stage, and then mostly what people actually need funding is at their growth stage. People have built the product and you have customers coming in, you are optimizing your product, and you can actually pivot your product as well. Sometimes what happens is you put a product out there, but you have to adjust it to meet the customer's expectations. So for an example, Urban.lk, that's my startup. So when we first came out with it, we had a lot of categories, different products. We had hobby shop items like racing cars, drones, perfumes, clothes, handbags, eyewear, electronics, gadgets, computers, mobile phones, everything we had there. But 6 months into the operations, we were able to realize with the data that we got, the concept that we are putting out there is premium products, like products that are a little bit more expensive. And we were able to identify what people actually come to our website for. One thing we realized was speakers, portable JBL speakers. That seemed to be a market that we could actually capitalize on. People were actually looking for that. So like that way, we pivoted our attention towards speakers and made that category prominent, and reduced categories that we thought will not actually be that beneficial for us. Because like sometimes maintaining those categories is a bit of work, and that is actually, we can actually use that time to improve our better performing categories. So like that, you can pivot your business while you're on the way, and once you have pivoted and you get more feedback on that, and then you have to grow your business. So if you take a diagram, so you started from somewhere here, and then you go down a bit, change your business model, and then you can shoot up from there. Not a straight line, but it's a exponential growth. So for this exponential growth, you need funding. So growth stage is another stage that you actually need a lot of funding for. And then you have to actually determine how much you need for this. And then who you get the funding from determines on that. depends on that. So one of the reasons why I said you should focus on how much funding you need. Sometimes maybe all you need is 1 or 2 million at this stage, but you have the ability to raise 10 million. You shouldn't actually raise that 10 million, because one of the reasons that, like, a lot of people don't do this also, why that happens is, to get 10 million when you need actually 2 million, you have to give a lot of your company out to an investor. So a higher percentage of your company is going out of their your hands, especially because you're at an early stage. So your company isn't worth that much. It's just an idea that is converted into an MVP. You don't have a lot of you don't have a lot to show to the investor. So they will actually ask for a lot of a higher percentage from there if you actually try to raise a lot more money than you actually need. So funding, you have to raise it in stages. At this stage, I'm only going to need 2 million. So with 2 million, I'm going to do this. I'm going to show these results. And then let's say 6 months or 1 year later, I'm going to raise another 5 million. Like that, step by step, you can raise your funding. And with the initial 2 million, let's say you got that investment for 5%, and you actually raised your valuation. Your company is worth a little bit more now. So for that next 5%, you don't have to give as much out, as much of a percentage to the investor. Let's say for the initial 2 million, you gave out 10% of your company. But for that next 5 million, maybe for that entire 5 million, you have to give maybe like 12% or 10%. So that you can keep a little bit more control of your company. Because something that happens is, when you get investments, like, you have to answer to the investor. And your control in the company goes down. And it is actually a good thing, because otherwise you are not accountable for anything. You are not answering to anybody, and you will do anything you want. It's sort of a, you get sort of a freedom that is a bit addictive and can be harmful for yourself also. So having an investor, actually you have someone overlooking your work, so you know, so you have to be accountable for someone. So those things that can happen is that, depending on your business plan, so we will get into business plans a little bit later, you can actually determine what kind of money you need and when you need it. So that is a very crucial point. You have to actually know how much you need to raise. You shouldn't raise less than what you need as well, then your business will fail, as you don't have money to go on. You can consider something called the burn rate. Have you gone through those technical terms that you might know? So we'll touch upon that a little bit later. So burn rate is every month how much you are losing. So when you consider the revenue from the revenue from your business and the expenses you have, what's the difference there? How much money are you losing every month? It can be like you're burning 100,000 every month. So let's say burning 100,000 every month, you have to survive another 6 months. So you need 600,000 raised. So like that, you can calculate how much you actually need. So we'll get on to who you should talk to regarding your funding. There are different kinds of funding methods. You have the angel investors, accelerators, bootstrapping, and venture capitalists. So we'll touch upon each of these a little bit. So bootstrapping is basically your personal money or your friend or family. You don't really reach out to proper investors. You just go through your connections and see people who have money and then tell them, I have this idea. So here what happens is they give you money because they trust you more than your idea. Essentially, funding is about that. People who fund you, fund your startup, essentially gives money because they have some faith and they have some trust in you. People fund a person more than the idea itself. So you need to show people that you are someone who has done their research properly, who understands the market properly, and you have to show that you have done a proper job. So those things, the amount of work you have to do at bootstrapping is less, because this is people who actually know you. It's not someone who's a stranger that's going to give you 2 million out of their money. So these are people who know you, and you have a greater accountability there. Because startups can fail. normal thing. Startups can fail anytime. You can have an idea, you can have millions of revenue, but it can actually fail at the same time. But the thing is, when you fail and what you owe money to is a venture capitalist or an angel investors, that's a very normal thing to do. They expect this. I have a small diagram on that also, I'll show that. But bootstrapping, something you have to look out for. When your startup fails, you have some obligation to the people who actually gave you money, because it's friends and family. So that's something you have to look out for when you get money. Because it's something that people don't really touch upon much, but you have to know that as well. So then we can go into angel investments. We can call them angels as well. So these are people who actually have probably done their own startup, people who are businessmen, they have a lot of knowledge, they have experience on building startups. So this is a very good way of getting money, because more than the money, you get advice, you get mentorship, you get a lot of connections, because these people have contacts all over the industry. So they can set you up meetings and set you up with mentors who can actually give you more advice on this. So angel investments is something that you can actually benefit a lot from. At the same time, you have to give a bit more equity than at some cases, depending on who you're talking to. And when you get into an accelerator, what you can see is that more than the funding itself, there also you get a lot of connections, you get the mentors. So my company urban.lk, we are in the John Keys accelerator right now, and what we value more than the money we got from there is the connection, because it's a well-established company and you can get a meeting set up easily. So that's the same case for any startup accelerator. It's usually done by people who are highly successful in the industry, trying to give their knowledge and help to small startups. So you can get the seed investments, connections, and meetings for sales, mentorship, education components, like workshops like these. So the accelerators provide you with these a lot. And they usually end up with a demo day or a pitching event, and then you get selected into the accelerator or you get more benefits from there. And then you have the venture capital method. This is a big one. So if you take PickMe, when they started, they got on with the venture capital model, because I think it's Blue Capital, right? Do you remember Blue Capital, right? Ajit Gunardana. So that is a VC company, and they got on with them at the beginning. That worked for them because they already had the MVP, they had done their research, they have actually built the product a lot better at that point. And also they were entering a market that had a lot of potential and nobody had tapped into that at that point. Uber was there, but in Sri Lanka there was no competition. So they decided, okay, what I need is a VC model, because they wanted a lot of money. I'm talking around 20-30 millions of rupees to start off with. So that's what they did. They did their business plan and realized that they wanted a lot more money to start off with, and they were okay with giving that equity away. Because the guy who started Sulfur probably had a very small percentage left for him at the start itself, but from the moment he started, he has a very good valuation, because his company is valued a lot more now. So that's something that you have to talk about. King or rich, you can have 100% of your own company and the company may be valued at 1 or 2 million, or you can have 20-30% of your company with giving 80-70% outside, but then your company is worth like 100 times more. So you have to not get stuck on valuations. At startup stage, it's very difficult to do your valuation properly, because VCs do it in a different way, angel investors do it in a different way. So it's a bit difficult to get a proper valuation done. So you have to be a bit flexible there. and make sure you don't lose out on the opportunity just because you wanted a bit more of your company to yourself. And it's actually a, you have to trust the VC, and the VC has to trust you a little bit as well. VC, the venture capital method, it's done through a fund. What they do is they have a professionally managed fund, and then they invest to other startups through this fund. And it's really good for expansion because you get a lot of money from this. And almost always they take a high equity. You have to give 20, 30, 40% of your company for this method. Most of the time. So to show you how a fund works, let's say these are four investors. So this can be one company, this can be one individual, like that. So they come together and form a fund, which now has $100 million in it. And from that fund, they take 80 million of that for actual funding. 20 million of that is maintained for marketing purposes. They can use this to market their own fund and have events, have workshops, give mentorships, those kind of things. So only about 80 million of this is actually getting for funding purposes. So from that 80 million, there's a cycle. Let's say, let's take this as a timeline. Let's say this guy got funded a little bit early, and then this guy gets funded the last. VC companies have a funding cycle. It can be like 10 years. They are not expecting a return of your money the next year or the year after. They usually don't even ask for a return on investments. Let's say you are getting money from your friend or family. You might have to actually give them and pay them an interest, which is going to be really bad for your company because the money you are earning is now going back to investors. But when you do it through this method, they don't ask you for interest. You don't have to pay them an interest amount and pay their money back from the start. What they are looking towards is actually cashing out at the end. So let's say they put 25 million into this guy, 15 million here, 32 and 8 million here. And let's say at the end, their cycle is 10 years. At the end of the 10 years, they sell their shares. And they have earned zero from that guy. So let's say that startup failed and they don't see their money again. The next guy, they have lost 15 million. Third guy has made them good money. And the best investment is the fourth guy. With just 8 million, they have made 150. So they are cashing out now. And collectively, they have earned 300 million from 100 million. So now, from that 300 million, the actual investors take 260 million, and the VC company can retain 40 million. Depends on how the agreements that they have. So these 40 million, they will again use for marketing purposes and workshops and other things that they can provide to the startups. Also, they have to pay the salaries of the people who are working for them. So that's how the VC method works. Do you have any questions on this?
I think this cashing like
that. Right, okay. So let's say the first guy, he's getting 25 million and the VC company gets 20% of their company. So that guy's startup, 20% of that is now owned by the VC company. So at the end of 10 years, they sell that share and get 10 million. Okay, so the equity is sold.
So they're selling the share.
Yeah. So they are not looking for the, like, let's say if when you are a shareholder, when it's a profitable company, you pay the shareholder some amount of money every year. So that's not what they're expecting. They're expecting to sell the amount and get a lot more cash into them. And you know about IPOs, right? IPO is the initial public offering. So when a company wants to get registered in the stock market, the first time they get registered, that's called the initial public offering. So that is one exit strategy for investors. So when the company goes public, a lot of money comes into the company. So from that, they cash out a lot. when you set up a private limited company, that company is an entity. So your connection is just managing the company. You can't be liable for things that the company does unless they are like criminal activities or things like that. For instance, like if you don't pay EPF ETF for your employees, the directors can go to jail. So like in Sri Lanka, I think about 3-4 years you can go to jail for that. So EPF ETF you have to pay properly. Other than that, let's say you lost the money, your company went down, you're bankrupt now, the company, you don't have to pay for that. So you're covered there. And another problem that you might have is now you have this great idea and you're going to pitch it to an investor and you don't really know whether the investor will actually take your idea and start it on their own, right? That is probably a question you have. So the thing is, investors probably get this idea from like 3-4 different people because they talk to a lot of people and they get a lot of ideas. And here what you have to do is you have to make sure the investor understands that this is the idea and I'm the one to do this. Like, why you're the person who should be doing this? And you really can't get funding if you are trying to keep all the information to yourself. Let's say you're pitching to an investor, but you're not disclosing everything about the company. You're trying to be a little bit vague and hide some details. Then they will get discouraged. They will feel like you don't really know what you're talking about. So the point is, show the idea, show that it's a good idea and why you're the one to do that. Why you're the specific person, the best person in the world to execute this idea. So those are the things you have to touch up on. And yes, you have to kiss a lot of frogs to find a prince. You will have to talk to maybe like 10, 20, some people have talked like 100 investors as well. I think in Sri Lanka that's a bit difficult, but a lot of investors you have to talk to until you find someone who's actually interested in your idea. And the good thing is, each of these meetings will teach you something. When you pitch to an investor, they will ask you questions. And sometimes you are not ready for these questions. You shouldn't lie. You should just say, I don't have the answer right now. Let me get back to you on this. So don't lie to them and give them false information. Try to give them a proper, honest answer. And now you know, okay, investors ask for this value. So I need to know this when I'm talking to an investor. So like that, you get more and more experience. You get better experience and you can improve your pitch as well. So always try to talk, like talk to investors, see, pitch your idea, see what they think. I mean, like, just because you pitch, you don't have to get their money. So pitch to them and see. Also, it will actually, for this is something that happened, like when we started off Urban, I had no idea about any of this. So we were learning everything online and I went and talked to a lot of investors and I'm pretty sure my first pitch was terrible and I didn't do any of the things that needs to be done properly and I got bombarded with questions that I didn't know answers to. So what I did was I went home, I looked up, some things I didn't even know what they mean. So I looked up the meanings, I checked what they actually mean, how they can actually benefit the company, then you get to know those things. And then the next ones I got to improve myself through those. So it's a very good thing to go to the investor and pitch. And but do be prepared. Like, don't just go and talk to them randomly. Be a little bit prepared on that. And so investors have a fear of missing out. So you have to use that to your advantage. There are investors that I know who have had the chance to invest in one of the biggest companies in Sri Lanka right now, 30 years ago. And they have just thought, okay, this is a stupid idea, it's never going to work. But now that company is worth like 100 times the investor's value. So that is something they actually have, fear of missing out. So sometimes they would even invest a small amount of money so that they can get the information from your company and get updated on what's happening, and so that when the company is doing well, they can invest a lot more. So use that to your advantage. And these days, everybody is talking about startups. People are putting a lot of money into the startup environment. So this is a very good time to start up, start your startup. So use that as well. So we'll move on to the second part, making sense to those that matter. So you have this idea, you have this great idea, but you need to convert that into a way so that it speaks to the investor. An investor can see that this is a good idea and they understand what you are trying to say. So this is where making a business plan, making a pitch deck, having an elevator pitch, everything comes in handy. So have you heard about elevator pitches? So it's basically you're going somewhere and you're in a building and you get stuck in an elevator for 60 seconds, 30 to 60 seconds with an investor. So now in this short time period, you have to tell them what's good about your startup and try to get their attention and get them to get interested in you. So that's the whole idea of this. So in an elevator pitch, you have to definitely keep it brief. You can't be boring and annoying the investor there. So that's why typically 30 to 60 seconds you use. And you have to share your skills. You have to make the investor know that you're someone who has some credibility and know what they are talking about. And you have to mention your goal and always have your business cards ready. It's very easy to print a business card. You just have to design it on Photoshop or somewhere, or get a template from Word or something. Very easy, have them ready so you can actually present to them, because you have to give them a call to action. You can give them the card and say, this is my email, you can contact me, or take their card. So there should be a call to action at the end. So let's talk about creating an elevator pitch that fits your business. So there are different types of elevator pitches. Some are they start grabbing your attention. It starts with a question. So basically the point of that elevator pitch is to grab their attention and give them time, like give them something to think about so that they can contact you back. And the other thing is a reality check, which is you are talking about an issue that the market currently face, and you are talking about a solution to that. So it's basically like a very steady flow. And the other thing is data back. You can say, did you know that 90% of people are having this issue every day at this time, and nobody's come up with an issue solution for this? So something like that. So you can actually show that you have some data to back your pitch as well. That actually gets them to trust you a bit more. They will do their own research, but they will actually have your you will actually have their attention. You can say who you are in a very short manner, and you can have something to say, something to grab their attention, typically a question, and then you can state the problem and the solution and your USP, your unique selling point. What is the uniqueness of your business? And then, as I mentioned, call to action. Typically, the business card and asking them to contact you back. So you can come up with a elevator pitch, you can refine it, and we can practice it. You can practice it a bit more as well. Also, this is 30 to 60 seconds. Don't try to put a lot of information into those 30 seconds. You are actually speaking super fast. So that's just gonna annoy the investor. They are gonna be like, who's this joker? So just be confident, speak slowly, and make sure that whatever you're saying makes sense, not just some jumble there. Don't just leave it hanging so that they can be like, oh, okay, and move on. You can give them an option to contact you or get a way of contacting them. Usually emails are exchanged very freely. Even the biggest investor would not hesitate to give their business card with the email, or just give their email. So it's okay to ask their email. If you're okay with this, if you're interested in this, can I have your email so that I can send you over a proposal? So proposal, you have to keep it ready. If that happens, let's say today, at least send this by 8 o'clock tonight. Like, let's say you meet the investor now, try to send it through the same day so that they don't really forget about what happened. You can actually, because thing is like, if it's an, it depends on the investor as well. If it's an investor who actually knows about the construction industry and the issues of that, they will know about this. Or you can actually do something like, so did you know that construction industry is having an issue, particular issues like this, and we are trying to solve this with our product, this, that actually can do this. So like that. So try to word it in a way that it's easy to grab and give them a little bit more attention also. So depends on the investor as well. But I think it can be a little bit more attention grabbing and fast. So you're going to be like, hi, my name, I'm this person, I'm from this place. And then also when you're planning for the question like, are you someone who's playing sports? Be ready for the negative one also. If they say, no, I'm not interested in sports, try to have like two different versions, then you would know like these issues are there. So then let me tell you about the environment, the sports environment here. And also you can be compress this. Like, let's say you want to play a sport, but you don't have a team. So you don't have enough friends to make a team or something like that. Like, same thing, you can find different ways of compressing it. So same thing comes there, so fewer words, so they can actually understand it a bit better. So I like it, you have different types of iterative which is going on. So your one is the data background. So you have a lot of data on that. So the bad part of data back is you can go overboard on that. You can have too much data, isn't it? So try to compress that as well. You can do this by you can pitch to your friends who don't know anything about this and ask them what they think. Did they understand the problem? Did they understand what you're trying to say? So that's a good way of improving. Other than that, I like the approach. Now let's talk about the actual pitch. The business plan and the pitch deck. So pitch deck is what you actually present to the investor at a demo day or some presenting event. So you are more prepared, you are properly dressed, you are prepared, you are mentally prepared for everything. So you can do a perfect job there. And let's see how you can get onto that. I have some examples also from Airbnb. So Airbnb had a pitch deck when they started, which actually grabbed the attention of a lot of investors. So there's a edited version of that with new images. I have the example, we'll go through that as well. So business plan is basically a guide, and it's like a roadmap to your goals, and you can describe how you're planning to achieve them in the business plan. And there are a lot of templates in the web, and let's say if you can actually spend a little bit more money, you can get the subscription model of Live Plan. It's free, they have this money back option as well for 1 month. So let's go into why you need a business plan. So your business, your startup is actually a business. You shouldn't run your startup as a product, expecting it to make money or get profitable later on. You need to have a proper plan on how you're going to make it profitable, how you're going to reach more customers, how you're going to make it big. So the business plan will help you with that. It actually makes you think about different aspects of the company. Mostly, you're focused on the operations part of this and how to reach the customers. You don't really consider the financial aspect of it. A business plan actually helps you think about that. And it's very beneficial if you can actually have a person who's dedicated to looking after that as well. And the CEO should be someone who's looking after the finances as well. So in our company, I'm the co-founder. I founded this with my brother. He's the CEO and he's looking into the financial aspects of it, while I can focus on the operational and marketing aspects. So that's the good thing about having a team. So you can actually delegate your responsibilities. And then you're going to identify some problems that you might come in the way. One can be the taxes, the VATs that you have to pay. For instance, let's say if Airbnb was to come to Sri Lanka and register as a local company and just perform like that, one of the problems they will have is their commission is 10%, but from the end result, they have to pay 15% of VAT. to the government. So they have to give that 15% to the customer, which is going to increase the price. Let's say from Airbnb it will be 1,500, and from if you actually go there and book it, it will be much cheaper than that. Let's say it will be like 15% or 12% less than that value. So you can't actually have that as well. So those things you have to find ways to tackle. For instance, Airbnb can actually do that on a commission-based model where their commission is the revenue. So there are different business models. You can register your business in Sri Lanka. So you can look into those aspects as well. So a business plan does focus a bit on financial aspects, so you can actually identify those problems. So you do prepare. You can prepare for a better future, and it will actually help you understand your business better yourself as well, so that you can explain it better to others. Because now you know the different aspects of it, and you are doing the research for each and every one of them. So now you know the business better, you know the marketplace better, you know the competition better, so that you can actually explain why your solution is better than everyone else a little bit better. And so I'll go through these. These are the things that I included in our business plan. So as the opportunity part, I stated what the problem is. The problem that we, like, let's say for urban.lk's case, the problem was Sri Lankan e-commerce was not giving good delivery, delivery time was heavily delayed, and the customer service was bad, and there were so many knockoffs and non-original products. So my startup is not technically a novel idea that nobody ever had before. But a lot of startups are new ideas that you don't really have a lot of competition on. So my idea, it's an existing model that I'm trying to improve. So that's the problem I stated. The current problems the market was having. So the solution to that, so what can we do to improve that? What kind of approaches can we take to tackle each of these problems that I stated early on? And then I did a market research. What's the size of the market? And what's the size of the market that I can actually capture? And what's the market that I currently have? So when I was pitching for the accelerator, my business had been running for 2.5 years. So I had some data to actually back my claims. Sometimes when you are pitching, you won't actually have that data. But what you can do is you can actually do research on that. Similar businesses have been there in similar markets. For me, the similar markets were not India, but Malaysia and Singapore. So like that, you can find similar markets that behave the similar ways to your product, the Sri Lankan or whatever market you're trying to target. And then the competition. You have to talk about the competition. Who is already doing this? And who is already actually doing this? Who's putting money into this? So those data, and also why your solution is better than their solution. And then, yeah, that's the other one. And then you can get into the financial forecast. So the burn rate that I was talking about earlier, how much money you're going to lose every month. So how much money you're going to raise between this period, and then after that, are you going to pitch for more money? How you are going to do that? Salaries you are going to pay? So all these details. And marketing and sales. The marketing channels, it can be online, newspapers, TV, radio, referrals. So whatever channels you are going to do, you can put them and the proposed budget for those. And then the sales plan. You are going to market it this much, how much of sales are you expecting? And in the first years, from experience, I'm saying my sales plan expectations and the reality were quite different. Sometimes it, like, some periods did better than expected, and some aspects did much less than expected as well. Because, like, without proper experience on the subject, you can actually assume a lot of things which are going to give you incorrect data. So try to always go through whatever information you can find online and think about this a lot better, and try to make a business plan. Because the issue is sometimes you can get stuck to the business plan and not improve as well. Because you are expecting these goals, but they are not the actual goals you are supposed to be chasing. So he updates the business plan constantly so that you, with the new information you learn, you can do a better job. And then you can talk about the operations, the locations, the technology you are using, and then the milestones. You can set up milestones. These are the targets I'm going to reach, and this is when I'm going to reach, and these are the metrics that I'm going to be focusing on. At this stage, have a few metrics that you're going to be focusing on, like revenue, maybe commissions, number of people who use the application, things like that. Make sure it's not a lot of metrics, because you can't be, you don't have the time to go through all these metrics and improve each and every one of them individually. So you need to find out what metrics you are the other most important, and then focus on those few metrics. Otherwise, you are going to get drowned in data, and you have so much information going on, you don't really know what to make of this. So always try to like have a few metrics so that you can monitor them regularly and improve your business. And let's say 2-3 months down the line, you feel like this metric is not going to be important to me, or like it's an important metric, but I can't really be working on that now. I don't have the capacity to work on that now. Then you can get rid of that metric as well. And then the financial plan, you can do by revenue by month you're expecting, expenses by month, and the net profit or loss by the year. And the last bit is a bit like complex, and at the very start you can't really come up with these, but it's good to know that you're supposed to have the projected profit and loss, the projected balance sheet, and projected cash flow. So these are business terms and business concepts that you can easily find online. Like, we didn't actually know exactly how to do this. I had done commerce in all of us, but after that I did maths. So everything, we were able to find the information and how to do this, everything online. So you can actually learn about this as well. Don't get like worried about those aspects. And when you're actually performing and operational, you can hire someone to look after these data. So we'll move on to the pitch deck. So as I mentioned earlier, pitch deck is what you're going to be presenting when you're doing the actual pitch to an investor or a panel of investors. So it needs to be concise, and it needs to only have the things that should be there. So for instance, let's say whatever I'm saying right now, if I put it there, you're not going to be listening to me. You're going to be trying to read the slides. The same can happen to the investor, and they are not going to be giving you any focus. So try to just put, let's say, figures. You can put the graphs, and you can put the title, or like, let's say now I'm talking about pitch deck, so I have the word pitch deck, so you know that I'm talking about the pitch deck. So don't try to put too much as well. And usually you can do a small branding at the end as well. If you have a logo set up, you can do something like that as well. Just don't put too much information in that. You can have a standard pitch deck that you perfected, and before the pitch you should customize that to the investor. You have to understand, like, you have to do a research on the investor. So a lot of information about the investors you can find online, and places like Crunchbase has a lot of data regarding their investments as well. So go through these things, find out what they have invested, what kind of money they have invested, how much they have invested, what kind of industries are they interested in, and see if the industry they have invested, how they are performing now. Gain as much information as you can possibly can, as you possibly can, and customize the pitch deck to them. So let's say you're pitching to an investor who's looking towards, for your example, let's say the investor is looking towards helping the community with regards to sports. So maybe within the pitch deck, you can have something like, this is what you are going to do to the community as well. So like they can actually see that, okay, I have this idea to do this, I can do this through this as well, while making some money as well. So like that, you will get different ideas on that. So once trying to pitch to an investor, I actually found out a lot of information about them, how yeah, they went to school, what they did in school, where they graduated, what they did after that. So you can actually get this information easily. So all that information, I took it in like 3 hours. So it's very easy. You just do your research and customize it up, like according to the investor's requirements. And I'm not saying change your product, I'm saying change your pitch. And also something to look out for, what they are scared about. So for instance, Sri Lankan online market space, people are scared to get into this because a lot of people have invested and they burned their hand. They didn't get a return on their money, the companies went down, they are not profiting. So that's something that we realized when we are trying to pitch into investors. And we started with differentiating ourselves from the everything else, like having a clear path to profitability and what we are going to do to be profitable. So things like that, you can see what the investors are scared about and then change your pitch according to that. So your pitch should be something like this. You have you start off with a normal flow, and then you talk about an enticing incident, and then it's like a movie, it's all going up. Like, so we have this, we have these people saying this about us, we have done this much about this. It's like everything good about the application. So it's rising up, and the climax is your product, how good it is and what it's going to do, and the how much money it's going to make, all those things. And now you have the falling action. So the barriers you have, what are the problems you are facing? These are the problems I'm currently facing, and these are the problems in the market. This is why I can't expand because I don't have enough capital to reach the market. So things like that, the issues, you can talk about that, and the resolution. So this is our plan, this is how we are going to do, this is how much we are going to raise, and after that, this is what we are going to do. So things like that. So that's the general way of doing the pitch. So let's go through an example. This is something I found online. This is not the original pitch, but the content is from the original pitch, but the logos and pictures are different. That's a difference. So Airbnb, you're familiar with Airbnb, right? Everybody knows about Airbnb. So they can let you book rooms with locals. So it's a little different than booking a hotel room and going there, and they put that up in their pitch as well. So they outline the problem. So like I said, don't put a lot of information, just what you are trying to say. So they were talking about the price problem, so that it's expensive for people to actually travel and book online. So the price factor they put there, because that it's at the end of the day, that's one of the main issues everybody has. And they were focusing on the aspect that hotels leave you disconnected. So they were focusing on people who are going to another country to explore the culture of that country itself. So those kind of things they put there. And the issues, the no easy way exists to book a room with a local and then become a host. So now they have three issues that they have highlighted, and they're going to talk about that. So the solution, they have talked about a web platform and the solutions to the above problems that they mentioned. And then you have the market validation. So this is an important thing, because market validation shows that you have done some research on this. You are not just someone who had this idea some night and trying to come up with an app about it. So these show that you have done some research, and you are not just doing this for the sake of doing a startup and becoming your own boss. Because a lot of startups have a lot of people start startups to just fund their day-to-day operations and just live a normal life. But that's not what an investor is looking for. An investor is looking for an idea that can take them like that can make them a lot of money. So you have to show that your idea is going to make them a lot of money. Otherwise, there's no point in them investing in your startup, because there are these things called lifestyle businesses. Otherwise, they're going to see that your startup is actually going to be a lifestyle business. So you have to show that the potential of your business is enormous and that they can actually benefit a lot from this. And then you can calculate the market size. So that's a bit difficult, and I'll talk about this a little bit. Like, I'm pausing the example a bit to talk about the market. So when you're talking about the market, there are three things you can consider. TAM is the total available market. So let's say for PickMe, that's a global taxi market, taxi hailing market globally. That's their total addressable market. And their serviceable available market is the market they have available in their geographical reach. So for instance, their SAM is Sri Lankan market, number of people who are actually using taxis every day, like that. So the global one, the geographical one. And then from the geographical one, the serviceable obtainable market is the portion of the SAM that they can capture. Because there is going to be competition, there's going to be other options, people are going to drive. So those things considered, how much of a market share they can capture from the serviceable available market is the serviceable obtainable market. So these are terms that are generally used when you are talking about investments and funding. So it's better to know about these. And basically the SOM is the realistic percentage of the SAM. So apart from this, there's another market called the beachhead market. So that market is the market that you use to get some feedback on your product. Let's say for your product, you can target a few people in a university. You can say that, okay, I think the university people have a potential to do this. Or you can say, okay, university people have enough friends, so they don't need this. So I'm going to be targeting this for people who are at home, not going out, the introverts and all. So you can identify a specific market and use that to get feedback and test your application. That's the first market you are going to be targeting on. That's called the beachhead market. So then you can talk about your product. Talking about the product, they have put some screenshots, what kind of interface they have. So this is a new picture, so I'm assuming in the original pitch they had their first images. And the options that you have, the features, then you can talk about those. And the final point, like how they are going to do it. And then you can talk about the business model. So we take 10% commission on each transaction. So that's a big question for any investor. So okay, you have this idea, how are you going to make money out of this? So are you like, let's say if it's a product that is out for selling, then it's a bit obvious because you're going to be selling the product. But if it's an application, you have to show them how you're going to make money. So your business model needs to be clear. And the market adoption, how you are planning to market this, the marketing channels that I was talking about earlier. And they had this interesting thing, the Craigslist dual posting feature. So what they did was, Craigslist was this classified website that you can post anything and get people to actually engage with that. So what they did was, people who posted Craigslist listings saying that people can come to our house and stay for $20 a day, what they did was they identified those things and sent them a message saying, we saw that you have a Craigslist posting, you can have the same posting for free at Airbnb, and this is our rates and all everything, we have this much of a rate reach, all you have to do is just click this button, all your data will be there in Airbnb. So they fetched the data from Craigslist, prepared the entry at Airbnb, and just ask the permission of the people to just take it live. So that was a very creative way of increasing their postings, get more people to post in their website application. And also now what they are doing is they are sending you a professional photographer as well, so that all the photos in Airbnb are high quality and they look professionally done. So those are small things you can learn from them. So do some research on these startups that are doing really well now. Even the startups that failed, you can learn what they were doing wrong. So, and then the competition. So competition is very important because competition is healthy. Because if there are other people actually spending money on this same thing that you are trying to do or in a similar way, that means people who have done their research have deemed this to be a good way of making money. So there are other people who think this idea is good too. So then they don't have let's say they are coming into a market with no investments, nobody has put any money into this, the risk there is very high. But if it's a competitive market where you can actually put some money and get some share as well, they know that they are not taking that much of a risk as well. And you can do something like this, have your competitors listed and say what parts of that is good about them, what part is bad about them. See, this is like a basic graph that you can use for that. And then show what you are doing better than the competition. So take a few slides to talk about the competition as well, two or three. You can say what you are going to do, how you are going to do it better. And then the team, that is very important because you have to show who are actually behind this and why they are the best people to do this. Because as I mentioned earlier also, investor invest in the people more than the product. So you need to show them that your money is going to be in good hands. And then you can put feedback and the PR about your product, what people have said about it. And then you can put the financial details. So now this is the business aspect of it. So you can show how much, if you have invested, it can be money or time, put that as well. Because if you are not investing in your own idea, why would the investor invest in you? So you need to show that you have put some money, you have put some effort, you have actually invested your life into this as well. So that they know that you are serious about it. Let's go through some technical words that you might find along the way. So revenue, you know. And then you have the customer lifetime value. So this value, what it does is, when you acquire a customer, from that customer, how much money you can make. There are a few different ways of calculating this. You can find this online. There are ways of calculating this with the profit margin. There are ways of calculating this without that as well. You need to find, just do some research and see which one should be the best for you. So I said that there are two ways, which considers the profit margin and which doesn't consider the profit margin. In our industry, mainly people were using the method that doesn't consider the profit margin. But for us, we are using the one that considers the profit margin because we are trying to show that even though our competition has proven to be unprofitable, we are trying to make it profitable. So it depends on you, depends on your business, who you are pitching to. You need to figure out what kind of a metrics you are going to be using for that. And then the average basket size, so order value, you can actually get that easily. And the CAC, customer acquisition cost. To acquire one customer, how much you need to spend. So essentially, this is the total marketing budget divided by the new customers you acquired. Customer acquisition cost. So CAC to LTV ratio is also considered. CAC over LTV. So usually what it says is the ratio should be 3:1. And if it's less than 3:1, it's not good. And if it's more than 3:1, that means you have a market that you haven't captured yet. You have a potential market that you need to capture more better. So that matrix also, some investors just ask you what's your ratio, 3 CAC to LTV ratio. Know that as well. And the churn rate is the rate of customers you are losing. Let's say every month, how many customers you are losing. That needs to be a important matrix as well. And the burn rate, as I mentioned earlier, how much money you are losing every month. retention, how much of your existing customers come back and use the app, continuously use the app, come back for you, and the valuation that you know, and the exit strategy. So what's your plan for this? How you are going to make the big chunk of money out of this? Are you going to go global? Are you going to go for an IPO? Are you going to get acquired? That is a very feasible and a very good way of exiting. People, like, you can actually build your company to get acquired. So for instance, Instagram, WhatsApp. So those things, they didn't make money while operating, but at the end of the at the end of their business, when they are selling it off, they make a ton of money. So that way you can see what kind of an exit strategy you have to be adopting. Investment, getting the investment is not the end of the road. That's just a big milestone that can actually start, your work actually starts from there. So now you have the money, you have to actually do the work now. You have to get the operations going, the marketing going. So a lot of investors, when you like get the investment, they come to you and say, okay, this is just the beginning now. That's why I just put it there. They always make sure that you know that your hard work doesn't end there. Because up until you get the investment, it's a lot of work. You have to do a lot of research, you have to talk to a lot of people. But now after that, the work gets even harder. So don't expect the work to get any less reduced because you got the investment. So even if you get more employees in there, you have a lot more work to be doing there. Before that, I want to talk to you about the CEO's main objective. The CEO has to make sure that your company doesn't run out of money. So that's one of his priorities, and that's what he should be focusing on. So if you have a team, get someone who's good at finances to look into that, look into the finances. But that guy doesn't necessarily have to be the CEO, because CEO has to get the funds, he has to talk to investors. So not the person who's most financially knowledgeable isn't necessarily the person who's best fit to do this. It has to be someone who's confident, someone who can talk to people, someone who's outgoing. So, and he should be someone who is able to manage a team, because managing a team is actually really difficult. And at a startup level, you don't have a lot of resources to manage them also. Making the salaries, making the pay slips, those things, they take a lot of your time as well. So consider those things. And after the investment, make sure you hit the targets. So always give reachable targets to your pitch. And you have to expect another thing. After the investment, as I mentioned earlier also, you have a lot of outside interference now. Other people are going to be looking to your business and see what you're going to be doing. See if you are doing it right. And they are going to be poking into the business a lot more. You might even get annoyed, but that's something you have to expect. It is good in a way, because as I mentioned earlier also, you actually have something to be accountable for now. So saying that, do expect that this is going to be happening after the investment. And then the team. So with the investment, you have to make sure your team grows, your marketing grows, your product gets improved. So make sure you have a very good team, otherwise your business is like, a lot of businesses have failed because they had everything right but the team didn't do a proper job. So make sure the team that you are getting into your company is the best you can find or the best there is. You have to do your research. Always see what kind of similar markets there are, what other people who have the application similar to this have done. For my experience, I was researching on Amazon a lot. Amazon, and there was this other online store called Souq, and those were having similar models to ours, more than eBay and all that, AliExpress. So we have done extensive research on there. A lot of these information is available online. Some things you have to talk to people and understand. So there is a lot of data available, so do your research. At the same time, don't get drowned by data. Some of these articles you can find are not credible. They will have different opinions on things. So be smart about your research as well.